Hello and welcome to the Soberania podcast, news analysis about Mexico, Mexican politics ahead of the 2024 election. I'm your co-host, José Luis Granados Ceja, a Mexican-born journalist living and working in Mexico City, although today I am coming to you live from the Pacific Northwest, as I'm actually on a speaking tour throughout the West Coast of the United States to talk about Mexico, the election, and everything in between. I want to introduce my co-host, Kurt Hackbarth, and he will be helping us on today's program to talk about a pretty major piece of news that came out yesterday that, like in our last episode, is a really good example of everything that is wrong about coverage about Mexico.
Exactly right. Here. That's exactly right, José Luis. Thanks very much. My name is Kurt Hackbarth, coming to you from Oaxaca, Mexico. I write on Mexico and Latin American affairs in Jacobin Magazine and Sentido Común, and happy to be here for episode one now of the Soberania podcast. So, as José Luis said, we've got yet another example of smoke and mirrors to analyze today. And it's funny how things are going over the last few days as we're beginning presidential campaign season here in Mexico and, of course, the U.S. Just a few days ago, there was a hack of the presidential computers of the administration of López Obrador, and there was a leak of the reporters that assist or that attend his morning press conference called the Mañanera. Then we had the attack from the Baker Institute, alleging that Morena might, maybe, be in cahoots with organized crime, led by Tony Payan, who gave an interview to Texas Observer, which was then picked up by the Reforma newspaper down here. Then NPR kicked in with their story, as we covered in last week's episode. And then Jorge Ramos shows up as he kind of swoops in now and again to the presidential press conferences to again attack AMLO on violence statistics. And then today, we've got something new. What have we got, José Luis? Oh my God, look at this. Did drug traffickers funnel millions of dollars to Mexican President López Obrador's first campaign in 2006? Funny how the article, this is in ProPublica, written Jeopardy style as a question, right? It's kind of a weaselly title, isn't it, José Luis? Did they? Well, I don't know. Did they? Isn't what this article is supposed to be proving?
Now, listen, I work as a journalist, but the truth is I actually didn't go to J school. But even I know that when an article poses a question, 9 times out of 10, the answer is no. And that it's doing that precisely to kind of weasel their way out of it. And I think that alone tells us what we're in store for when it comes to this story. And the fact is that it actually wasn't just this one. There was what we call here in Mexico, el nado sincronizado, or the synchronized swim. You made a great point in on Twitter, on X, saying that, well, at least be a little bit more careful next time. At least try to space it out. Quite literally within hours of each other, we saw this article, we saw something from Deutsche Welle, from Anabel Hernandez, and finally from with the outlet Insight Crime, which is a digital outlet that focuses on organized crime and the like, but kind of takes a liberal pro State Department position on most issues when it comes to security policy, particularly when it comes to Global South countries.
Yeah, that's, as I said in my thread, try to at least be a little bit more subtle, guys. Let's put that thread up, and then we can actually go through the article, and we can see how this is what I called the anatomy of a hit. Right? So let's put that
let's put
up.
That up there.
Yeah, and let's see exactly how this works. Okay, so as I put here in my thread, this is essentially another clumsy attempt by the U.S. to meddle in this year's Mexican presidential election, and also to influence the American presidential election, as we'll talk about in a minute. How does it work? Number one, as José Luis just mentioned, the synchronized swim. Spread your story at the same time across various media outlets to make it look more serious, right? So it's not just ProPublica. It also came out in Deutsche Welle and Insight Crime, as José has mentioned. A little obvious, though, to do it the exact same time, right? Point two, as we just mentioned, the weasel headline, right? ProPublica runs with this headline, right? The article's by Tim Golden. Did drug traffickers funnel money to AMLO's 2006 campaign? As José Luis very well said, 9 out of 10 times, the question title is no, right? And actually, this isn't the only escape hatch that Tim Golden created for himself throughout the piece, right? Tim himself seems very clear that there's really very little here, right? So he, in very careful journalistic language, he's trying to effectively make something out of nothing without catching himself on the hook, right? And anything that could then be a statement that could be very easily disproven.
That's right. But let's get into the meat of it. What's the actual accusation? How are they even putting this kind of headline out there? What are they actually trying to say? What is the basis of this story? What are the allegations?
The allegation is that in the 2006 campaign, people close to López Obrador received money, in exchange for, you know, trying to influence presidential policy when and if AMLO was elected, right? To the tune of, what was it, some $2
million,
right?
$2 million. I want to take a pause there. Yeah. It's an extraordinarily small sum of money. I think they're almost making fun of us to our faces when they suggest that a candidate like López Obrador, with a political project that even in 2006, he very clearly represented a break with the old regime, he would be willing to throw away the soul of his project, his integrity, and say, as these articles allege, that he was willing to basically hand over security policy and let the organized crime groups have free reign. There was even suggestions that they would have vetoes over who would be appointed police commanders in the border regions where they're most active, et cetera, for $2 million. Now we're talking about organized crime groups that literally manage billions of dollars.
That's right.
The fact that they think that a person like López Obrador and all of his political trajectory, even back in 2006, considering where he came from and all of the effort it took for him to achieve the prominence that he did, that he'd be willing to do it for what is basically petty cash to organized crime groups, is frankly off base, but I'm willing to say grounded in some racism. Surely these stupid Mexicans must be willing to do whatever it takes for a little bit of cash. How much could you really get done? Because the allegation is that the $2 million would go into the campaign funds and for campaign work, that would be enough to just hand over your security policy the way they did. It borders on the outrageous that they would think that we would actually fall for something like that, that alone would be enough. And I think really kind of gives you an idea of how much credibility we should put into any of these reports.
Yeah, it's like the modern equivalent of the idea of trinkets and mirrors, right? For $2 million, the AMLO campaign would have thrown it all away. Also, the piece is based, the DEA's whole case was based on a very discredited source, a lawyer by the name of Roberto López Nájara. He was revealed by Proceso magazine about a decade ago to be the codename Jennifer. He was a former operative for the Beltran Leyva cartel, among other sterling points in his resume. And he was also Felipe Calderon's top witness in Calderon's attempt to weed people out of the government in his time. Felipe Calderon was the conservative president who stole the election in 2006 and imposed the very bloody drug war on the country between 2006 and 2012, during which time his security minister, Genaro García Luna, was in cahoots with the Sinaloa cartel. Not mentioned in the article. A strange omission, don't you think, José Luis?
I think that's one of the things that also was quite appalling about the ProPublica piece in particular, is that Felipe Calderon is mentioned quite sporadically and never put into any context. And Nover mentions that there very much was a candidate in 2006 who was suspected of having close ties to organized crime, but it was not López Obrador. It was Felipe Calderon. And we can get into the details about whether or not we should, you know, to fairness to Calderon, he claims he never knew, right? I find that hard to believe, but let's say we'll take him at his word, he never knew. Nonetheless, his right-hand man, his security chief, the man who was empowered to actually carry out the federal government's security strategy, he is currently imprisoned as a result of being convicted of drug trafficking by a U.S. court. Now, you know, the same kind of authors may say, well, you know, a Mexican kangaroo court found him. No, this was a U.S. court, you know, the one that they place so much faith into, the same institutions that were unwilling to engage in these kinds of unscrupulous behavior in the elections when it came to López Obrador, very much had a case when it came to García Luna. And so the fact that that's omitted is actually a journalistic crime. I think if you're going to be talking about the collusion between organized crime groups and the political parties in Mexico, and you don't mention that the security chief was caught red-handed collaborating with organized crime groups, you're committing a crime and lying by omission, and that's dishonest. And it's a shame that it's coming from an outlet like ProPublica, which does have the mission of speaking truth to power, of contesting this, that has produced some good reports. We should, you know, be honest about that. But really, and this one, like the Texas Observer that we analyzed in our last episode, has really missed the mark. And I think, as we said in the last episode as well, right, part of it has to do with the fact that I'm sure Tim is a very nice guy. I'm sure he's published great works, but he clearly does not know a thing about Mexico.
And the thing about Calderon is, you know, it's like Reagan with Iran-Contra and all of these, I don't recall, right? Either Calderon knew and let it go on, which means he's complicit with the Sinaloa cartel, or he had no idea what his security minister was doing. What kind of president was that? It doesn't look good either way at all, right? Now, to go back to Nájera, Nájera is not only, you know, any old unreliable witness. He's actually blown a couple of cases, right? These names are not going to mean much outside of Mexico, but the former commissioner of the federal police, Javier Herrera Valles, right? And a general, right? Tomás Ángeles de Oare, both of their cases were dismissed, they were exonerated, precisely on the inexactitude based on the bogus testimony of Nájera, right? And this was the main source for this case that AMLO supposedly, or his campaign, ProPublica is very careful to say nothing, there's nothing that ties AMLO directly to it. It was his people, right? Some of his people, supposedly. Their main source on all this is Nájera, right?
And interestingly, when this story came out, the Latinus, which is a media outlet that is funded by politicians from the PRI and very much is used as a tool to bash the López Obrador government here in Mexico, you could practically hear them salivating as they were writing this tweet and putting it out there. This report just came out. Now, I think the reason that an outlet like Latinus wasn't included in this synchronized swim in this instance is because it's harder to pull the wool over people's eyes here in Mexico. They know who these actors are. They know right. who Nájera is. And they remember that he was the super informant who actually had a very dubious record. And so then that's why they go to these gringo outlets who are willing to run this, right? As I prepared an article for the Mexico Solidarity website, mexicosolidarity.com, please check us out, read it, share it with your friends, where I say right this, here. Inside Mexico.
Right there on the screen, right?
Yep. Inside Mexico, however, López Nájera is a widely discredited figure, a fact that the ProPublica report only reveals at the end of their story. ProPublica cites a May 2013 report by Mexican news magazine Proceso that publicly revealed for the first time the true identity of the informant until then only known as Jennifer. López Nájera came to be seen as an untrustworthy figure that provided information to prosecutors that was politically convenient to then-President Felipe Calderón. The former Mexican president, who launched the so-called war on cartels early in his presidency, is only mentioned sporadically in the ProPublica report, and no mention is made of Genaro García Luna.
And if many people only read the headlines, or the first paragraph, how many people are going to get to the end of the article to read exactly that information that they bury at the bottom? Right? That's not, you know, that's not random. Right? That just, you know, that's just ass covering to throw it in at the end. Now, my point four in my thread is called the unwitting revelation, right? We've talked about what the pieces, these three pieces, don't reveal. Here's what they do reveal: that the DEA was trying to set up and effectively blackmail AMLO's 2012 presidential campaign for fear that he would shut down their operations. Let me read this clip from the article. Okay. Some officials felt the evidence was not strong enough to justify the risks of an extensive undercover operation inside Mexico. In late 2011, DEA agents proposed a sting in which they would offer $5 million in supposed drug money to operatives working on López Obrador's second presidential campaign, which was in 2012, the following year, trying to set up the campaign, right? Instead, Justice Department officials closed the investigation, in part over concerns that even a successful prosecution would be viewed by Mexicans as egregious American meddling in their politics. Really?
Really? At that point, they're right. Yeah. Although you'll notice that they'll say things that Mexico is particularly sensitive about this issue. Again, as if sovereignty is something that's up for negotiation, as if that is something that would be tolerable anywhere. No.
As if no country would accept a presidential candidate trying to be set up and blackmailed by the DEA, right? Mexicans are especially sensitive about that. Nobody would accept that.
Nobody would.
Right?
And if anything, the reason they're scared is because they know it would produce a backlash, that there would be very much a response, even from sort of the old political class in this country, to say, that's a step too far. Are you really trying to entrap a presidential candidate or his team ahead of an election?
Entrapment. That's exactly the word. And it's funny that it got to that point where they decided this was going to be too far, a step too far for them. This was their bridge too far, right? Openly entrapping a presidential candidate.
And you got to love the way that they framed it, right? It was the bomb squad of the DEA that diffuses any potential bombs. I think that they passed that point long before they finally decided.
That's why I said it very tongue-in-cheek. That was their bridge too far. nobody was trying to influence the election, one official familiar with the investigation said, but there was always a fear that López Obrador might back away on the drug fight, that if this guy becomes president, he could shut us down. Let's just think about that for a second. The DEA was planning on entrapping or attempting to entrap a presidential candidate because they were worried that he would change the open door policy of the previous administrations toward U.S. intelligence agencies in Mexico. So they're going to try to blackmail him for that.
That's right. Entrap him and try to keep him from actually winning the presidency. I don't know what you call that, but for me, that is absolutely interference. And while we're on the point, I actually wanted to read something else from the article that I prepared today. I'll put it here. Specifically around the issue of the relationship with the DEA. In a sense, they were right. López Obrador was not going to allow this open door policy that was very much the case under Felipe Calderón and even Enrique Peña Nieto, and obviously many before him. But we're talking about Mexico's modern history. But let me share with this view. Little is said in the reports about López Obrador's testy relationship with the DEA. Although the ProPublica story makes mention of the Mexican president's moves against the agency, which he very much has, he has limited their ability to operate, he grounded one of their planes. It only comes at the end of the report and is framed in a way to suggest that his decisions to sideline the DEA's allies in Mexico, because there were many groups that were officially part of the Mexican state, but were working very much as an extension of the DEA here in the country, to sideline the DEA's allies in Mexico were driven by his unwillingness to work with the U.S. agency and officials, as if it's just a ludicrous notion, as if it's just, on a whim because López Obrador is uncomfortable with the DEA. No, there is a very long history. And as somebody on social media put, the DEA does not combat drugs. the DEA controls drugs and is very much involved and has been caught red-handed engaging in really unscrupulous behavior throughout the Americas. He has very good reason to want to sideline the DEA and their activities, especially because of the following, which I'll read to you here from the article. López Obrador's landslide victory in 2018 came in part as a result of the Mexican population's exasperation with the two preceding administration security policies, which followed the U.S.'s favored policy of arresting and extraditing drug trafficking kingpins. Despite promises from Calderón and his successor Enrique Peña Nieto, little progress has been made towards improving Mexico's security situation. Under López Obrador, homicide rates have remained high, but for the first time, there's a marked decrease in violent crimes. The ProPublica mentions Obrador's marginalization of, quote, Mexican commando teams that had been the most trusted partner of U.S. law enforcement and intelligence agencies, end quote. The commando teams in question are tied to the SEDO, an investigation unit focused on organized crime from the now defunct federal police. This unit's chief is likewise imprisoned in the U.S. as a result of the drug trafficking conviction. Again, these are things that by leaving them out, you are lying to your readers. This isn't just some crack COP6-like commando team. No, they were also caught red-handed because, again, as we say, in Mexico, with Felipe Calderón, it wasn't a war against drug cartels. It was a war amongst cartels. The state very much took sides and was actively intervening, and even some actors were benefiting financially from this. I want to just play with this. I quoted Viridiana Rios. She's a Mexican author and academic. Follow her on social media. She often does tweet in English as well. And she said the following in response to this article. Quote, testimonies that have never been validated are now suggested as true, with the sole argument that, according to ProPublica, Mexico has not confronted the drug trade with the force that the USA would like, as if confronting it during Calderón's presidency would have made a difference, end quote. And then I say this, by the DEA's own admission, the source of their allegations had a credibility problem. So why didn't this move forward? Because his story didn't add up. And they did not have the confidence to continue to pursue this line of investigation and to engage in what was very much going to be an effort to try to entrap either López Obrador directly or his campaign aides. I go on. The reports also make no mention of regular leaks from DEA-linked individuals undermining AMLO's security strategy. Unlike his predecessors, López Obrador has severely curtailed the ability of U.S. agents to operate inside Mexico, even grounding a plane used by the DEA in its Mexico-based operations, rubbing the agency the wrong way. In the article, I also make a point of quoting Carlos Pérez Ricard, another academic. He focuses on security strategy, and he said this of the story. I read this story as an attack by one part of the DEA against the government of López Obrador during a critical moment in the presidential election. There is no other way of reading the matter and substance in which this story was published.
Okay, so this is, you know, as you said, this is very important context that was omitted, right? And they couldn't have not known what they were omitting, no? I wanted to just reflect on what was going on in Mexico precisely at that time, right? So I'm gonna go back to my thread here. At the precise time that Felipe Calderón's security minister, García Luna, was colluding with the Sinaloa cartel, right, which the DEA saw and heard no evil about, they were instead focused on this stupid sting operation on AMLO, right? Isn't this amazing, José Luis? Isn't that amazing? Here we had a government and Felipe Calderón, right, now that is extraordinary, isn't it? Here we had a government in Felipe Calderón who was fairly openly siding with the Sinaloa cartel, right? In a war that killed over 100,000 people, right? Directly, it was a kind of a war of extermination against the poor, right? Who were basically the cannon fodder in this. Right, and it was mostly the poor communities who were affected. Truly, a crime against humanity what happened in Mexico over those years. Right? DEA saw no evil, heard no evil with regards to that. Saw no evil, heard no evil. You know, and it's funny that if you go back and read accounts at the time, right, there was one account where functionaries from the U.S. Embassy were invited out to one of Garcia Luna's palatial houses, right? He showed them, you know, his car collection, his, you know, antique car collection. The corruption, the drug money was staring them in the face, was staring these people in the face. Nothing, right? Nothing.
Changed nothing. Right? He was still one of their most trusted allies in Mexico.
Award-winning, you know, a prized person in the United States. And after he left office and formed a security company in Miami, who were some of his partners? An ex-DEA agent, an ex-CIA agent, and an ex-FBI agent in Miami, his security company, after he left office in 2012. So not only did they see no evil, hear no evil while he was in office, you can at least make the case, well, he was in office and we couldn't go after an elected official. It's a pretty flimsy argument, but okay. Even after he'd left office and was a private citizen, they could have gone after him without any, you know, obstacles of him being an office holder or a cabinet member. No, they went into business with him. They went into business with him in Miami, right? So the DEA saw no evil and heard no evil with regards to Garcia Luna, right? But they had the time to set up a bogus bullshit sting operation against AMLO, trying to set him up and trying to entrap him with $5 million.
And let's not forget, like, the motivation was that their fear that his policies would actually change the U.S.-Mexico relationship when it comes to drug interdiction and the activities of the DEA. So what it is they were looking out for their own skin. They have all these plans and conspiracies set up, ready to implement in a country where it doesn't matter how many people have to die as a result of their ludicrous plots, right? In order to protect that those interests from going forward, so that they could go to their bosses and being like, look at all of the kingpins we're bringing down. Look at how good we are at our job at intervening in the entry of drugs into the United States. But I think also it's important to talk about the domestic case, right? And I think you make the point here on this thread, and obviously you can expand on it, but I like what you say. If there had been anything incriminating against AMLO, they absolutely would have used it in 2012 or 2018. As it is, they're just trying to use some old wash of story to influence this campaign cycle. So talk to us a little bit about the situation, the fact that this is happening now, that they all came out at the same time. This is right after the Baker Institute's report, that this is right after the NPR smearing on its programming, et cetera, right after Jorge Ramos. Obviously, there's something happening here. There are actors who are moving some pieces behind the scenes, it seems.
But you know, it's funny too, right? Because the Democratic Party and MSNBC and the DNC have half the country, United States, convinced that the Russians interfered in the 2016 elections in the U.S. on the basis of a couple of Facebook pages, right? Here we have real-time election interference happening right in front of the entire public. And who cares, right? Who cares, right? Because it's Mexico. And this is how the United States interferes in elections all over the world. And we're seeing it happen in real time, right? Sting operation, which apparently didn't go ahead, if they had had any evidence, the thinnest thread of evidence that AMLO, even somebody close to him, had accepted drug money in 2006, they would have hit that in 2012, right? When AMLO was running for a second time against Enrique Peña Nieto, which is basically the restoration of the PRI, right? And it got fairly close at the end, right? Despite Peña Nieto's buying votes, buying the election, handing out debit cards that supposedly had money, and it was a bought election, right? Bought and paid for. Okay. So 2012. Then they had another chance in 2018, if they had evidence, to go after AMLO when he was very clearly winning. That is, after 2006, they had two election cycles, two full election cycles, to come out with this story against López Obrador when he was running directly. And they didn't. And they didn't. That shows you how flimsy this story is. Do you think that they wouldn't have, had there been anything there?
Of course not. There's nothing there. There's nothing there. And so that makes me ask myself, who else is talking like this? What other constituency is talking about Morena's alleged ties to organized crime, the way that the Baker Institute and Tony Payan did, the way that these articles are trying to suggest? It's the Mexican opposition. They're the ones who are trying to put this out there. And I, again, want to read from the article that I wrote today, where I say the following. Languishing in the polls and seemingly unable to grow their support among the population, Mexico's political opposition has recently shifted strategy, employing political operators famous for running dirty campaigns. One of the more recent allegations the opposition has leveled is claims that López Obrador and his Morena party are in cahoots with organized crime. This criticism has been echoed by voices inside the United States, including Baker Institute's Tony Payan and David Frum, former speechwriter for U.S. President George W. Bush, though no material evidence has been proffered.
David Frum was aghast with today's news. He was aghast. Yes.
Similarly, none of the recent reports offered any new material evidence to back up the serious allegations. Instead, the most recent report relies almost exclusively on the word of U.S. officials, including the Drug Enforcement Agency and their criminal informants, who, as the stories themselves readily report, were interested in avoiding imprisonment. Again, quoting Vidi Rios, she says, ProPublica reporter Tim Golden receives old information from the DEA, to which he adds nothing genuinely relevant. And I can't help but agree with her. There is nothing new here. This is part of the synchronized swim. This is responding to the Mexican election. But also, and I'm hoping you might be able to chime in on this, I think it also reflects a bit of what's happening in the U.S., because as we know, they are too in an election year. And we have seen a lot of language coming, particularly from the Republicans, around this issue of fentanyl, around this invasion that's coming from this U.S. southern border with Mexico, et cetera, et cetera. Where does the U.S.'s election play into this whole thing happening right now?
Well, this plays right into the U.S. election, right? And in a sense, has even more to do with that. What's the idea here of this piece, right? The smoke and mirrors, that everybody in Mexico is bought, right? Everybody. Everybody's colluded. Everybody's bought. It's a big episode of Narcos, right? One side is bought. The other side is bought, right? The current president received narco money for his first campaign. And now in this campaign, his party may be in cahoots with the cartels again, you know, the bogeyman, right? I'm just conflating the Baker story with today's story because it's very, very much similar, right?
It's all the same.
So the idea here is Mexico can't govern itself. It's a narco state, can't control its border. And the United States has to intervene, right? So Biden's policy now to stiffen the border and be able to close the border when a certain number of migrants come through, which is what he's trying to propose now, is justified. But more than that, Donald Trump's proposal to create concentration camps in the country, right? Round up people wherever they're from and dump them onto Mexico is warranted, right? And more than that, military intervention in Mexico is warranted because they're all in cahoots with drugs. As simplistic and as dumb as that.
And frankly, like I said, racist, right? What underpins a lot of U.S. foreign policy is a certain degree of racism. And so moving on to, I wanted to also highlight an article that you wrote that I invite people to read as well. I'll put it up here on the screen, which comes in Jacobin, which actually talks about the whole U.S.-DEA-Mexico relationship. Maybe you could talk to us a little bit more about what are some of the things that you talk about in this piece here.
Yeah. This piece, which came out a few months ago, talks about how the DEA ran an operation here for a year and a half without informing the Mexican government to go after the Chapitos, right? The sons of El Chapo, right? Director Ann Milgram talked about how they proactively infiltrated the cartel and obtained unprecedented access to the organization's highest levels and the whole thing, right? Basically, the DEA's whole thing was an indictment of their own kingpin strategy, right? Their kingpin strategy is to knock off kingpins of cartels as if that will knock off the cartel itself. And then the Chapitos are supposedly even worse than El Chapo, right? And then in the next section, I go on to all of the scandals of the DEA, right? All of the scandals, right? Ann Milgram herself, right, is under investigation, right, for supposedly handing out contracts to cronies in New Jersey, no-bid contracts, paying money to this lobbying firm, Wilmer Hale, which is where the U.S. Ambassador Ken Salazar comes out of, for a whitewash of the agency's disastrous overseas operations, right? This is the DEA which we're supposed to believe, right? This is the DEA, right? No bid crony contracts, whitewash external reports. If you want to keep scrolling a little bit there, this is the DEA we're supposed to believe, right? Now I want to read the section Team America in full because it's important. The Wilmer Hale report isn't the only one to whitewash DEA wrongdoing. Coverage in the U.S. press has been spotty, and in Mexican media, virtually non-existent, right? This includes the case of former Mexico chief Nicolas Palmieri, transferred and then allowed to resign for his chummy social relationship with Miami lawyer David Macy, who has represented prominent defendants in the drug world, such as the Colombian Diego Marin. Although Palmieri left the agency in 2022, the hush-hush affair was only pried out by the AP in January of this year, which was last year, a year afterwards, right? Or the case of Agent John Costanzo Jr., accused of providing sensitive information to intermediary and former agent Manny Recio, who in turn was in the employ of, yes, Miami defense lawyers. Or the case of Agent Chad Scott, the white devil, sentenced to 13 years for stealing money from suspects, falsifying government records and committing perjury during a federal trial. Or the case of Agent Nathan Cohen, sentenced to 11 years for thousands of dollars in bribes from California drug trafficker Francisco Gonzalez Benitez. Or the case of Agent Fernando Gomez, sentenced to 4 years for helping a drug trafficking ring avoid detection from law enforcement. Or the standout case of Agent José Irizarry, sentenced to 12 years for running an extensive money laundering operation that included, he contends, federal agents, prosecutors, informants, and cartel smugglers, all in part of a three-continent joyride known as Team America that chose cities for money laundering pickups, mostly for party purposes, or to coincide with Real Madrid soccer or Rafael Nadal tennis matches. That included stops along the way in VIP rooms of Caribbean strip joints, Amsterdam's red light district, and aboard a Colombian yacht that launched with plenty of booze and more than a dozen prostitutes. And here's the kicker. Here's the kicker, last paragraph there. And who, according to Irizarry, taught him the tools of the trade? The contraband king himself, Diego Marin, defended by Nicolas Palmieri's Miami friend, David Macy. Thus does the circle close. This is the DEA we're supposed to believe. This is the DEA we're supposed to believe, right? That they're disinterested agency, with no corruption of their own, very generously giving information to Tim over at ProPublica, right during, just coincidentally, a presidential campaign here in Mexico, which involves the party of López Obrador in the lead, right? Very funny that.
And not very funny that. An overwhelming lead. And I think that's the really key thing.
Amazing, isn't it?
Mind here,
this is the
right?
DEA.
Because we're already seeing
And the problem is now that we've got, in the wake of Russiagate in the US, all of this worship of intelligence agencies, right, by the Democratic Party. And so this is going largely without question of any kind, right? I just want to go back and finish my my thread here on Twitter. Point five here is the rehash, right? And this is very, very, very important. At the time, New York prosecutors were underwhelmed, quote unquote, with the evidence of drug contributions to the 2006 campaign. Let me read this section of the ProPublica piece. After going over the recordings, the New York prosecutors were underwhelmed. For such a sensitive and risky case, they felt the evidence needed to be nearly irrefutable. The agents nonetheless proposed to move ahead with a sting operation directed at AMLO's former driver, Molinedo, and other aides. How they proceeded from there, and whether they went after López Obrador and other politicians in his orbit, would depend on what the agents learned. And here's the headline in today's Sin Embargo in Mexico, right? The United States and the reporter back off. The AMLO case has been closed for 13 years, according to the Justice Department. And I don't have evidence, according to Golden. So the whole case here in ProPublica is based on something that had so little evidence that the Justice Department closed the case 13 years ago. So what are we talking about? Why are we talking about this? Why are we talking about a case that was closed 13 years ago for lack of evidence? And if you think they didn't have the most, the minimal evidence against AMLO, they would have proceeded, but they didn't. They closed the case. And yet it comes up again. And here's point seven in my thread, the motive. AMLO's national security law of 2021, which limits the operations of US intelligence agencies on Mexican soil. Doesn't get rid of them completely, didn't kick them out completely, but any operation they want to do has to be in coordination or at least informed with the Mexican government. They don't have the freedom of movement before. I think you can't carry guns. The DEA hates this, hates AMLO, and wants to continue running amok in Mexico as previously. And so that's the story, right? Interesting, isn't it, how this works? You get a story that has no legs, you spread it around so it comes out in different media so that it looks serious, right? Based on a discredited witness, but nobody in the US knows that, although in Mexico they do, which is why they didn't try to publish it in a Mexican outlet, right? Based on this credulous belief in the DEA, right? And dredging up an old story that was closed by the Justice Department 13 years ago, just to try to discredit the Morena Party in the lead up to the 2024 election. So after all of this analysis, here's the good news, ladies and gentlemen. If this is all they've got, Morena should be pretty happy, because this is pretty weak sauce. There's nothing there. Just like there was nothing there in the Baker Institute piece or the NPR hit, this is just another attempt to try to throw spaghetti at the wall and to try to conflate the idea of López Obrador cartels, Morena cartels. Kind of a flailing attempt from the Mexican opposition and their connections in the US press through think tanks, through academia, through their contacts there, to try to smirch the front runners who have a 25 to 30 point lead. It won't be the last one, but this one is not going to last too long, I think. I'm Kurt Hackbarth. This is the Soberania Mexican Politics Podcast for José Luis Granados Ceja. Good night, and we'll see you the next time.